Hey all of you chemo sobbies, this is Xena. Welcome to the May 2nd edition of 30 with Tony. We suggest you stop working, get on your porch or in your yard, get a cold drink, sit back, and enjoy the show and the fun.
Myself, why should I work so hard? Sit and dream about the days to come. Half a dress, just soaking up the sun. Sitting here, I hope I don't get fried. 2 years ago, you know, I almost died. And yet, there's nothing better for your soul than lying in the sun and listen to rock and roll.
Well, hi, Kimasabis. It's Tony D'Angelo. It's May 2nd, 2024. Out of Domini in the year of our Lord. So happy to have you here today. So happy for your participation, your sharing of our show, 30 with Tony. So happy that I'm getting more and more compliments on the music. I'm starting to get jealous, but I mean, I'm the guy picking the music. And I'm just so happy that You're benefiting from this. I am benefiting and bringing it to you. Our subject today, let's just get right down to it. Make it hurt, make it happen. Business in Connecticut will make you sick. Or let me get technically correct. Yeah, business in Connecticut will make you sick. And we're going to talk about some things that, you know, really kind of have just gone by us so quickly. And I mean, we hear about them, we see them, but yet in their unbelievability, we do not believe that it's capable of something that actually could take place and something that actually could happen. Allow me to elucidate, and we're going to get into a good discussion about all of this, but I'd like to start off here, if I may. Let me just start a screen share, and I'm going to go to there, and here we go. This is an article, Connecticut Mirror. This would be April 24th, 2024. And we're talking about the apparently soon to pass, if not passed already, sick leave expansion heading to the Senate. Now, let me just give you a little bit of background on this. The article is written by Mark Pasianakis, and I believe it is an accurate account of what has taken place. I don't see any of the usual inherent biases that I do with a lot of the, you know, so-called Connecticut press writing opinion pieces described as journalism to us. But, you know, we're wise in this show. We know better. But this said, the government has this idea to any small business person that they know more about running business than you do. Most of them have never held private sector employment. Most of them have never, ever, ever done anything, probably not even a lemonade stand or not even, you know, selling Girl Scout cookies, but yet they are these great human rights crusaders. The human rights crusaders that are crusading, I don't think they realize where the crusades come from with respect to, you know, their sustenance. They come from forces much greater than them who have an agenda. In Connecticut, it is a very pro-communist, pro-union agenda. And as long as, you know, they get their funding, in some cases their bulbous salaries, and, you know, live to go another day, they can criticize the rest of the world who's actually working for a living, making a profit, sending their kids to school, owning property. Oh, God, we can't do that in Connecticut. You know, keeping their kids out of jail and educating them and things like that. But they can criticize us because they know more. But to make a very long story, very, very short, the paid sick leave expansion in Connecticut for small businesses passes the House and heads to the Senate. Now, I am a small business owner. I have reviewed this, and I'm not going to give you my opinion on it yet, but let's go down. You can draw your own conclusions. Here's four men on the floor of the House of Representatives. And the actually three of them are mentioned. Darrell Wilson and Manny Sanchez of the Labor Committee, and House Speaker Matt Ritter, and his counsel, Ricky Baltimore. Okay, so there's four people, I'm sorry, and they're mentioned. And you look at that picture, and my first thing is, here comes trouble. What are they going to do to me now? And the article goes on, 13 years after Connecticut required a narrow slice of private sector employers to offer five paid sick days annually, the House voted 88-61 on Wednesday for legislation that gradually would transform that limited mandate into a nearly universal benefit by January 1st, 2027. That's a highly operative date. Let's look at that. Now, we read down the article. Passage of the original law was of greater political than practical significance It only hit a few people, but it was a foot in the door. Reading from this paragraph, but the majority of employers and employees were exempt. It only applied to 50 or more. Seasonals were not covered, nor the YMCAs and YWCAs. But now we have something called House Bill number 5005. You know, so many of these idiots, not Mr. Pazianowskis, because he did the opposite. But so many of these idiots write articles and they pontificate about the bill says this, the bill says that. They don't give you the bill number. You know, it's like, well, get this from me. I'm telling you where it's at. It's like, you know, shut up, pipsqueak, and get in the corner. I really don't care what you think. Give me the meat of the matter. But anyway, House Bill 5005, the measure approved, this would be Wednesday of last week, would repeal most exemptions and lower the threshold from coverage from companies from 50 to 25 on January 1, 2025, next year, to 11 in 2026, and to 1 in 2027. Now, the bill does not require additional time off from those that offer it, and that's it's targeting the ones that don't. And this comment here from Ritter is just, I mean, this is so condescending, and, you know, I don't care about you with respect to small business that, I mean, honestly, truthfully, I'm not going to say what I'm thinking right now about Mr. Ritter. I do not want it to be perceived as something worse than what I would say, but it's not very good. So this actually, this is the mindset of your pea-brained, state-supported, tax-sucking bureaucrat. So I think this just actually ends up covering a very small subset of persons, mostly part-time people working in very large fast food type establishments, chain type establishments, not the good local employer. You know, idiot, Ritter. What about the guy with a, like down the road here from me, on Route 44 in Pomfret, there's a lot of work going on in a restaurant, a roadside restaurant. And many people have tried to do something with this restaurant. Unfortunately, most of them have failed for a number of reasons. They've gotten good traffic, but, you know, I think it's people had different reasons for, you know, not carrying it out. And I go by there. These guys are putting in tons and tons and tons and tons of work. I mean, they're there every day. I see carpenters, I see plumbers, I see electricians. I mean, they want to do something. They want to make their lives better. And if it's going to be a shift type restaurant, you know, maybe something running from a, you know, 6 in the morning till 9 at night. I mean, honestly, truthfully, I'd like to see something like that here. It would be very convenient for me. I think it would be excellent for the town. And it's the kind of thing where, do they know that if they have 11 people employed and then coming down to one, that they're going to have to start accruing sick time, and they're going to have a large amount of cash in a liability account that they have to keep feeding, because if they don't keep feeding it, you know, should the floodgates come and people do get sick, or you get a couple that, you know, want to fake the toothache, backache, fingernail ache, or tummy ache, and then all of a sudden, you know, they're coming in and they're demanding to be paid, and if the money's not there, the business can go bankrupt. All that work goes to, you know, posterity, actually goes to a much worse place. And do they even know of something like that? Are they going to be encouraged in flouting the law? I mean, the burden here, the accrued burden that you're going to get from year to year to year is going to be amazing, because as we read down the article, and we'll see, is this benefit carries over. And let's just say, well, let's read down the article. Actually, I will not get down the article just yet. I do want to complete that thought. Let's just say that somebody is coming to the end of their tenure for whatever reason, and, you know, another worker elbows them and says, you know, if you say that you're sick, you can collect all of your accrued sick time. You know, get some Vinnie Boombach doctor to write you an excuse and say, you know, you're unable to work. You know, your knees are too sore to do whatever your task is. And you can sit there and get, you know, effectively free money for jaking it and faking it that your employer has to pay, and he receives no benefit from that because you're gone. You know, whatever benefit you brought to that job is no longer there. Whatever skills you had that you were able to use profitably there and benefit the employer, in many cases benefit the community, is no longer there. I mean, this is absolutely positively insane. This has got to be where it makes you sick to do business in Connecticut. I don't confess sickness in Jesus' name, but this has got to be the most job-killing piece of garbage and crap, I'll say it, that has ever come out of the state of Connecticut. And you've got to really move on that to beat the horrors that have come out of it. I mean, basically what you're doing is, rather than saying to a business who can adjudicate itself, the owners of that business are committed in that business. If they hope to stay in business, they're going to have to do some things right. And if they want to not have turnover and not be idiots and lose people to better businesses, they're going to have to be good to people and provide flexibility. And if somebody's sick, either establish your own plan or give them compensatory time off or flip hours or something like that. It's, you know, without Big Brother breathing down your neck. So it's just, you know, this is just typical Connecticut nonsense. Let's move on. There's some commentary. So here's the brain trust looking at it, and they have no idea who they're hurting. They're hurting that little firm, that little restaurant, that little engineering firm, or that little accounting firm that needs, you know, clerical people. That's who they're hurting, because the firm is going to have a liability account going forward that is going to get bigger, assuming no one is sick. Or if they choose not to have a liability account, they could be potentially hammered. If that were the case, perhaps become bankrupt, perhaps lose their businesses. And if you have a large amount of cash in your business and, you know, you get into a cash bind, that's like telling a hungry person not to open the refrigerator. Of course you're going to use the cash that's there. And how many people are going to be disciplined enough to pay that money back into the accrual? Because the accrual is not mandatory. That's the whole thing. The accrual, you can go entirely and say, I hope nobody ever gets sick and I'll pay them as they go. God bless you. That would concern the living hell out of me, you know, because you could get yourself fried if a number of people are sick and you did not set aside the cash to provide for it. What in God's name are these people thinking about? This is pure communist oppression Marxism. So, wouldn't it be nice if some people from the Republican Party actually called this communist oppression Marxism and said, these people that are in this legislature are communists, they're Marxists, they're horrible. We may lose every single vote. We may never, ever, ever exist as a party, but this madness, this garbage has to stop. No, normally we get diplomatic statements with a little spice thrown in. House Minority Leader Vincent J. Candelora R. North Branford said House Democrats were misleading the public and their own block of moderate members in downplaying the bill's impact and suggested they would face a backlash. No stuff, Sherlock. The moderates had convinced Ritter not to call a vote last year. The building is burning, and you're trying to remain cordial. I don't get it. I don't get it. I think there is a time to remain cordial. I don't believe in, you know, barbarism, and I don't believe in, you know, in whatever you want to call it. I tell people on this show every week, you have a First Amendment right, but not a First Amendment right to battery. But basically, I mean, this is really the death knell for Connecticut business. It basically is, or Connecticut small business. And these, well, let's read on. These dippy little activists that come are actually the, you know, the spawn of the great unions that want to take over every single small business. And Mr. Candelora goes on, this is the policy the Democrats want to eat or want to pass, and they can choke on it. It's not something that's sustainable for the state of Connecticut. It's unfortunate. It's being downplayed as no big deal when in fact it is. This is going to be a problem for every small business. How about Representative Candelora? This is going to kill every small business. This is dire. This is the blood gushing out of the arm, and there ain't no tourniquet. That's basically what this is, you know, because how can a small business manage a sick pay liability? I mean, do they go to the bank and do they borrow money at interest? What if they can't do that? What if they don't have bankable credit? So, you know, where are they, on some internet site or, you know, Vinnie Soprano with the 3 points a week? I mean, this has got to be the most brainless thing. And I mean, the Republicans at least said something, but as we'll read on here, gosh, you needed to do a whole lot more. This needed to be drilled into the head of every single Connecticut person with a small business. Now, of course, you got me on board. You have others on board. But instead of saying this is legislation and this is what people want and this is going to be bad, you've really got to call it for what it is. It is cultural Marxism. It is the worst policy known to mankind, when a bunch of bean brains, losers, and people that have never run a lemonade stand or shoveled snow off of Mrs. Calabash's stoop or something are dictating economic policy. They also dictate energy policy, too. You know, they also they tell us what cars to drive. And, you know, they've anyway, that's another show for another time. But article goes on. It talks about the margin of victory from 2011 going forward. This comment here from Representative Dave Rotigliano, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, in Trumbull. 10 years ago, Connecticut was the laughingstock, the butt of every joke in the country. Some of the worst economic policies going, massive tax increases, massive employer mandates, said Mr. Rotigliano, a restaurant owner. Do we really want to go back there? Mr. Rotigliano, are you watching a movie of a ball game 10 years ago and thinking that's not happening today? And you think the movie that you're watching is really today's ball game? I mean, pal, it's here. It's here. It's been here. Our reputation is so bad because of stuff like this. You know, this is not the land of opportunity. Think of it. Think of it. You want to start a small business in Connecticut, like these guys down the road here with the restaurant. I mean, they're going to have to deal with the sick pay accrual. They're going to have to deal with the paid family and medical leave. They're going to have to deal with the inane, ridiculous, stupid, ill-thought-out Sean Scanlon Retirement Security Authority plan. You know, we have a controller who runs around eating an ice cream cone talking about retirement. And as I've told him from time to time, I don't think he understands the present value of a dollar. It's pretty clear that he doesn't. And they're going to have to look at that and say, well, you know, maybe I'll do this in Florida. I mean, honestly, truthfully, I was faced this week where the opportunity presented itself for a greatly expanded business. The idea of doing it is one thing, but thinking about all of this has quickly dashed doing anything in Connecticut from my mind. Now, I could easily employ I don't know, 15 people, 20 people. I know how to do it, been doing it for 40 years, but ain't gonna be doing it here if I ever do it at all. I mean, you see what this comes down to? People will look at it and say, well, I'm not gonna, put myself there. What are the lunatics gonna do next? It's like my business would pay more than the minimum wage. What if they want to double the minimum wage? What if they want to do something really stupid like Karen Bass in California and say, why don't we have a $50 an hour minimum wage? How about this? Why don't we have a zero minimum wage? Zero. Zero. Let the market set the wage and the wages will be bidded up. But you see what that does is that gets rid of the uselessness and the useless people and the garbage policies of government. And they don't want to do that. They don't want to do that. And the people that should be advocating those policies and pushing back harder are trying to be civil with them. This is a forest fire. This is something so bad that it deserves no respect whatsoever. This is absolutely insane. Now, one comment here from Mr. Passianoskis. Lamont, a Democrat and former business owner who casts himself as a business-friendly leader. I like that. He can cast himself as a business-friendly leader, but really what he's doing is he is presiding over the intensity of this forest fire, pun intended. Endorsed a similar bill. The path to it becoming law is now smooth. Now he makes a statement. Notice he doesn't come out much anymore because he doesn't want to hear all the things that he really is and what he is in terms of the type of person he is and the policies he endorses. He cannot defend them. He is really the feckless King Ned Lamont the Unaccountable. And here's a statement. The legislation approved by the House today strikes an appropriate balance between protecting our workforce while also enacting safeguards for small businesses to ensure that this right is not being misused. Oh, my Lord. Lamont said, I applaud the House and I encourage the Senate to approve it so that I can sign it into law. Now, here's my boy Rojas, right? The savior of the downtrodden. People no longer want somebody who's sick coming to work. People who are sick themselves, I one of them, no longer want to go to work ill if they can avoid it. Okay. Jason, I call you an idiot a lot, but now I guess you're calling me an idiot back because what you're saying to me as a business owner is I cannot adjudicate myself if somebody is sick and spreading germs and, telling them, okay, you better stay home today. And dealing with that and dealing with them fairly, because if I don't deal with them fairly, they will go to competitors. In my case, they get scarfed up by, state-connected slobs, and then they come back trying to collect my unemployment because what we give people here is an incredibly marketable skill. So you're telling me that I don't know how to adjudicate that, and you've got to adjudicate that for me. This is what makes government so reprehensible. And, quote unquote, shall I say, the process, why people cannot relate to it and why they don't want to participate in it. Now let's look at some math. We're going to look actually at the bill itself. Employees would accrue 1 hour of paid time for 30 hours work up to a maximum mandated benefit of 40 hours paid time off in a year. It would become available after the 120th calendar day of employment. That would be 4 months. And unused time could be carried over to the next year. And then there's some benefits here, or actually some flexibilities for seasonal workers and people working in restaurants. Now, more than a dozen states have passed this. They're all the loser states, all the loser blue states that are hemorrhaging businesses. This is interesting here. Steve Weir of Hebron, the ranking Republican, quizzed these gentlemen that we saw at the top of the article Manny Sanchez in New Britain on the fine details, and Sanchez paused to consult with colleagues. In other words, the guy's pushing a bill. He's got no idea what the hell he's pushing. And his chief counsel, Ricky Baltimore, advised him on the floor. Who's paying Ricky Baltimore, right? You know, it's the wonderful world of lobbyists. What a better government we've had if we can get the hell rid of lobbyists and have legislators dealing with people. Now, one valuable thing, Weir Candelaria and other Republicans said tracking would be an accounting headache. Now, accruing, nobody mentions that. And then there's this Sarah Ganong. It's a disingenuous argument. In this day and age, employees have common software. Everybody uses it, tracking how much you're paying employees and how much they're working. Hey, Sarah, get over here and track my accruals. You know, you give these policies and you've never worked a profit-making day in your life. And these guys are gung-ho. Because Ganong agrees with Candelaria on one point, her group considers the bill of priorities open to backing primary challenges to Democrats who oppose it. That's accurate. In other words, you know, we're going from bad to worse, and we're going to go and make the burdens bigger. Here's the people pushing this thing who are essentially the hired guns of the unions that have the money behind this thing. The Working Families and She Leads Justice, which formerly was known as the Connecticut's Women Education and Legal Fund, nice name change, led the lobbying effort. Ganong and Janice Woods Weber, the executive director of She Leads Justice, watched from the House gallery. And they cheered as they exited. More damage done. We did it. Okay. Earlier article, go over to here. This is Hartford Current. This would have been March. And it says it's going to advance Allison Cross, March 25th, 2024. Couple of interesting points. Senators Harding and Sampson, ranking members, said the affirmative votes from Democrats added to Connecticut's reputation of being a bad state for business. This tone-deaf proposal will hurt employers and employees by eliminating their ability to negotiate employment terms themselves, Harding and Sampson said in the joint statement. It'll make businesses reticent to choose Connecticut as a place to operate. It will raise costs for consumers. It also reveals how out of touch majority Democrats are. Big government telling mom-and-pop shops what they must do and forcing them to comply is their priority. Now, nothing wrong in that statement. It would have been nice if one of you guys said, these people proposing this are lunatics and Marxists, and they're going to make this state into the number one welfare state in the union. That would make me feel better, because that's actually what's happening. You know, it's one thing to say, oh, there's a problem. It's another thing, you know, when the building is burning down, it's another thing to say, fire, get the hell out of the building. And, you know, these are the things actually that where we want to see fight from Republicans. And when you hear complaints about Republicans, it's not making enough of a fight in these things. And just trying to see if there's anything else. Yeah, this is a salient point here. Look at the fine states, the fine economic powerhouses that are doing this. Arizona, California, Illinois, Massachusetts, Minnesota, New Jersey, Vermont, Washington, and Washington, D.C. In other words, a list of states to avoid. And here is the champion of working families, labor, all things communism, Senator Julie Kushner. And she makes the statement, it's bad public policy to put workers in a situation where they have to choose between paying the rent and staying home with a sick child. We're going to fix that this session. I feel confident. Well, do you think the adult with the sick child and the employer can work that out on their own? Of course not. You have to do it. One comment on the esteemed Senator Kushner. One of the people in my discussion group went to her over the weekend and said, who's going to handle the cost of this? And she said, "Oh, the businesses." I said, "Well, who pays the cost for the businesses?" And of course, the esteemed communist champion didn't answer. And this is how delusional these people are. Small businesses will remain. Every time we enact progressive legislation, there's always a concern that it'll be damaging to small businesses. Julie, I think you're really concerned. We heard that in the minimum wage discussions we had in the past. What we see is small businesses could do is survive and thrive when we improve the conditions for the workers. I mean, restaurants are closing left and right. No businesses are coming into Connecticut. You know, it's if it's not the scandal, it's the rotten conditions in the state. It's the Lamont scandals. If it's not that, it's oh, then we'll get to that. But where is the Department of Economic and Community Destruction in all this? Don't they want to foster business? No, they don't think they do. They're just there to write a check when they're told to write a check. But basically, if you want to develop economics, isn't your economic department going to these lunatic bird brains and saying, "Stop! Stop this garbage"? No, of course not. Of course not. Welcome to the fantasy world of Connecticut. But anyway, when you actually look at this, here's the legislation. Here's the actual bill. And this goes on for, let me just see here. Got the usual bunch of losers, lunatics, Marxists, and business killers at the top of it. The something I want to show you here. Of course, if you're writing a bill in Connecticut, you have got to provide the reason for an agency to get involved and screw things up. Because if you didn't do that, it wouldn't be Connecticut. I want you to look at something here. I think I can do this. Now, one thing, sorry, I went right by it. One thing that when somebody leaves employment, they do not take their accrued sick time with them, but of course they can jake it and fake it until they make it all back and then go. There's something here in the bill called a retaliatory personnel action. So if you get rid of somebody for cause, and that person has the right to claim. This is all the wonderful things that all these lunatics are throwing at you. That person has the right to claim a that they've been retaliated against. And you know, it's well, you're not a really good employee, you know, for real, so we're going to get rid of you in 90 days. And then this person has a gripe that you retaliated against me because I was about to vest in my unpaid sick time. And then what do you involve after that? You've got the wonderful labor commission and hearings and bureaucrats and people looking at you and speaking to you that have never, ever, ever, ever walked one inch in the miles that you have. And you're introducing bureaucracies on top of this. Now, none of the articles, Mr. Posianos' article, or Ms. Cross article mention anything about that, but this is the whole reason why we need to have better freedom of information access in this state, because you never know what these SOBs are going to pull. They would pull a whole lot more if they could get away with it. Believe me, they have absolutely no regard for you. And the other things that go on when you look at this monster of this burden that you're, I mean, no one is going to have any kind of a business set up in the state where they're just going to be accruing a gigantic unpaid sick pay monster. And it's very hard for small businesses to keep the light on, to keep the heat on, you know, to pay the taxes, to clean the place and all that other stuff. And now what you're going to do is you're going to throw a greater burden upon them, where these people, good employees, will always be reasonable. If they come and they say, I'd like to make more money, what a good boss does, so this is how you can make more money, and this is how we can do better here. That's what's called failing forward as opposed to failing backward, which is what the political system does. And this is the scum and the garbage we've got to deal with in this state. You know, plus an entirely ineffective opposition. Some good things said, but not nearly enough to somehow save small businesses from the morass of what is the Connecticut administrative state. Case in point, you go ahead and you introduce another bureaucracy to adjudicate as to if this person has been retaliatorily, and that's not a word, acted against. I mean, I'm not running a business so I can sit in front of a freaking bureaucratic board. That's not what I'm here for. I'm here to provide either a product or a service and to represent my client and my customer as best as I possibly can. Is there anything in anything that I've explained to you here that is of any relation or benefit to that? I need not even answer that question. Let's go on and look a little bit more. Here, if you're keeping score at home, these are the turkeys that voted for the bill, and these are the ones that voted against the bill. This is from the legislative page. It's kind of predictable as the people that did and the people that didn't. And the how could I put it? It's pretty much, as Mr. Pozzianoskas said, along, you know, party lines. And the stuff that you see is, I'm just want to. Is typical. Yes, Leeper, yes, Lamar, yes, Linehan, yes, Lutzenberg, yes, Comey. Listen, Robin, if the bar with 10 people isn't there on the way home, blame yourself. Don't blame me. Yes, McCarthy, Fahey. Yes, McGee. And I mean, you know, it's like, do you see what's happening? Do you care? And it's I'm lost. I'm basically lost. But if you're looking at this here, and I think if I'm very good about this, here it is. I'm better than I thought. Here's the actual bill page. And one of the things that caught me here, you know, you've got big organizations in this state, supposedly pro-business, the CBIA, the Department of Economic and Community Destruction, the Women's Business Development Association, that are all supposed to be pro-business, pro-small business, pro-bootstrapping, pro-getting it on. Here's the people that submitted testimony. I don't see any of these characters. There's Sarah Ganong again. I don't see any of these characters. They're saying, you know, you're killing small business. They're curiously silent. And why is that? Well, it's because they're all beholden to the king, basically. You know, they're all there for ostensibly what they can get. You know, and I think I'll stop to share if I can here. I don't even know where to begin. I'm so angry. When government becomes the biggest impediment to capital, which has happened in the state of Connecticut, certainly happened in all those other idiotic states, you're going to have major problems. No one will come here and do anything unless you get the Department of Economic and Community Destruction to write them a bribe. Why do I want to be carrying these burdens? Why do I want to be sought after by a retirement plan? If I have people and I'm concerned about them, maybe I want to do my own retirement plan when I have the money and get around to that. If I can't do that, maybe I want to give them a bonus and say, look, this really should go into an IRA for you. And people can administrate themselves, you know, without some idiot bureaucracy and a bunch of, you know, inane legislators telling them what to do. I mean, I'm beside myself and I'm horribly inarticulate this afternoon, but it's absolutely amazing to me. It is absolutely amazing. I had a discussion over the weekend. A good friend, client, has a house in a Connecticut city, and it's a three-family house, and he's getting bidded out by people that want it very badly because there is a high influx of Hispanic immigrants moving into a neighborhood where he had grown up. And this is in the city of Stamford. And it's and he's wondering, should I sell it or should I keep it? There's tax considerations either way. But it basically comes down to a major issue, whether he sells it or whether he keeps it. This is Connecticut 2024. Is what if I go back to Florida and squatters get in? Right. He's got a, you know, he's got a very sought after asset that is readily marketable because apparently there is a created housing shortage in Stamford. And because in this world, in the wonderful world of Connecticut, he'll never get the squatters out. You know, it would be absolutely, you know, whereas it would be absolutely impossible because the stupid system, so-called, would benefit the interest of the squatters over him. Now, he can take some money and, you know, pay his taxes, take his tax hit, and go to Florida where Governor Ron DeSantis has an anti-squatting bill. Does anybody in our idiot legislature talk about an anti-squatting bill? I haven't heard it. I haven't heard it. You know, it's like, why not? Why not? Is it now okay? Is this a way we get to transit-oriented development by stressing out the homeowners so much that they don't want homes anymore because squatters might end up in it? You know, if grandpa dies or something like that. This is amazingly insane, amazingly insane. And this is where brainless policies, elections do have consequences. But sometimes I think there is an equivalent or a greater consequence by non-thinking legislators who don't understand anything and don't think things through and think about, you know, playing the what if game and what that happens. I mean, they're just basically parroting what they think is a good thing, you know, without being an adult in a room. I guess if you're an adult in the room, you're not very popular and you don't get invited to parties and things like that. But this is absolutely insane. The policies and the lack of accountability in the state of Connecticut will be our undoing if this isn't changed immediately. I mean, right now, the apple cart's going off the hill. And it's when you've stressed small businesses to this degree, they're not going to want to actually ever begin to consider it. This is a show, when it's on replay, somebody's thinking about starting a business in Connecticut. I don't care. I got to tell you the truth. You show it to these people. You show it to your legislature. You show it to anybody wanting to do anything in this state and say, think twice. Because this is what's going to happen to you if you do. It's amazingly insane. And can it be stopped? I always try to be a hopeful kid and say it can, but it's going to take all you and me and others, because the political system here, really, other than hand-wringing and other than, you know, weeping when something terrible happens, you know, which is a large part of Republicanism, national and state, and in various states, is not doing nearly enough. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. We're cooking today, Mama. I am so hot, I can jump into a pool of ice cubes. That's how angry I am. We'll be back with the rest of the show right after this.
Hello, fun seekers. Since we like to mix fun with business, please enjoy another video classic clip, courtesy of the producers of 30 with Tony.
Today's classic clip is the trailer for the 1939 film Golden Boy. Young and promising violinist Joe Bonaparte faces financial difficulties. Despite his father's wishes for him to continue developing his musical talent, Joe decides to earn money as a boxer, even though it means risking hand injuries. For his 21st birthday, his father gifts him an expensive violin, hoping Joe will pursue his musical career. However, Joe persuades the nearly bankrupt manager, Tom Moody, to give him a chance in the boxing ring. Joe quickly rises in his new profession, winning match after match. But as his conscience begins to bother him, he questions his decision to enter boxing. That's when Lorna Moon, Moody's girlfriend, steps in to convince him to keep fighting. As Joe's success grows, gangster Eddie Fusilli tries to get a piece of the action by buying Moody's share. This turns the once sweet Joe into a hardened boxer. In the semi-final match against Chocolate Drop, Joe is determined to win. However, when he knocks out his opponent in the second round, killing him, both Joe and Lorna's attitudes change. Joe ultimately retires from boxing and returns to his father and his music. The film explores themes of ambition, sacrifice, and the clash between artistic dreams and the allure of fame and fortune in the boxing world. William Holden's performance in Golden Boy marked a significant milestone in his career, propelling him to stardom.
I need you, Lorna. I need you all the time. I wish I could give you everything you want.
Borneo says you could go far in the fight game.
A prize fight is an insult to a man's soul. And besides, it might mean the end of my music. I need these for the violin.
You better be on your toes when you step in that ring.
Your loyalty makes me shiver.
You forgot your promise and took the easy way out. And look at you now. A bad imitation of your gangster friend.
You shouldn't be in the ring, Joe. You belong in your home with your violin.
Ladies and gentlemen, main bout of the evening.
We will be back soon with more 30 with Tony. Back after this.
Falling in love was the last thing I had on my mind. Holding you is a warmth that I thought I could never find. I've seen visions of someone like you in my life. A love that's strong, reaching out, holding me through the darkest night. I feel a warmth in my heart and my soul that I never knew. This love affair gives me strength that I need just to get me through.
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us on the painful but necessary subject of business in Connecticut will make you sick. And got to tell the truth. You know, for many, many years, I was concerned about hurting people's feelings or perhaps saying the wrong thing, or is this the right time to bring something up? And I'm still very much concerned about that because I don't like to hurt people for the sake of hurting them, you know, and I want to be sensitive to people. I want to regard their humanity and their sensibilities, and I try very hard to bring things out at the right time. You know, timing is very, very important. You're not always right in your timing, but I believe if you're sensitive and you try to, you know, observe when times are one thing as opposed to another, you'll do a whole lot better rather than just being a bullhead and a boob. But I've got to, you know, and I used to be hypersensitive to that. I still am. But when things get so bullheaded wrong against any sort of rationality whatsoever, I've gotten to a point where I've just decided I'm going to scream and yell and do whatever I can to call as much attention to the horrors that are taking place. And that's exactly what they are. And I don't know. You know, I mean, I've had a lot of teacher friends tell me in the past that they would love to see a world where there were basic intelligence tests for parents. You couldn't have a child unless you had some, you know, basic things. And honestly, truthfully, it would be a much more orderly and better world if that were the case. There's a lot of parents that shouldn't be. And, you know, where I will not ever endorse abortion, I want to see the best for kids. And in a lot of their parental situations, it's just not going to happen. And it's a terrible thing. That's another big discussion for another time. But one of the things I really would like to see is a basic, I don't know what you want to call it, a four-function math, history, political science, sanity, rationality test for people in politics. If half our politicians, let alone Connecticut, but nationally, had any sense of economic wherewithal whatsoever, oh man, we would be so much farther ahead where they would see if they understood the value of a dollar, the present value of a dollar, it takes a dollar to make a dollar. Penalizing employers is only going to make it worse down the road. People are free moral agents. They can move to better environments. They can go to better employment if you're not doing what's right. I mean, basically what you're doing, which is so ridiculous. And people think that I'm this total libertarian, you know, far to the right person that has pictures of Donald Trump all over my, you know, my bedroom and, you know, office wall and things like that. Well, you don't see any Trump posters here. But basically, I mean, I'm not that. I never was that, and I'm still not that. I believe in good conservative policies. I separate the policies from the man. So does Jamie Dimon of Chase Manhattan, who is a Democrat, who is telling Democrats, you better understand we're talking basic economics here and not all these woke, idiotic, woke, you know, throw the net worth of a corporation into the garbage can policies that you're also married to coming out of your Ivy League business schools. And then you wonder why the business is not doing well because of something stupid like you did. Case in point, look at Bud Light, you know, look at some of the others. I mean, you know, people didn't go back. Bud Light will never get to, you know, where they were ever because of their stupidity, because of their woke marketing policies. But basically, if we had people that understood that, we would be in so much more of a better situation than we are right now. It is so clear. And I, getting to the fact that I'm not, you know, a, you know, whatever you may think I am, I read Upton Sinclair, I read The Jungle, and the policies that were in the Chicago stockyards in the late 1880s brought about the union necessarily so because of the cruelty of the workers that was taking place. So what you have now with these communist, democrat, democommie lunatics is they are bringing the oppression of the workplace back in vogue, except they're using government to do it. You know, they're using government to keep everything to where business will not get to a place where it's greater than government, because we can't have that. We've got to have government telling us, you know, when to shut down and a climate change emergency and a police state and things like that. You guys can't possibly do this on their own. We're going to create chaos, and then we're going to try to create more chaos, and then we're going to try to stop the chaos by creating more chaos. It's like, you know, go fly away and, you know, jump off a bridge. I mean, it's like government should really be doing just the basics. Just the basics. Keep the roads safe and moving. Police services, education. Limited welfare, except for people who cannot work and will not be able to work. But instead of being, you know, everywhere, it's like, oh, let's get the government to do it. You know, let's throw the whole thing off on the state. And this is the problem. The state gets bigger, the person gets smaller. Innovation ceases, business stops investing, people get stupider and become more dependent on government. Like somebody was telling me, a physician was telling me this, making children transgender when they don't understand what they're doing is going to create a sick and mentally ill person for as long as that person lives, highly dependent, on government. And government loves nothing more than that. That's basically it. I believe in government. You need government to do the basics. I don't believe in free libertarianism, at least not me, because people aren't that well disciplined. If everybody was half as disciplined as I might be or you might be, we can get by very well with libertarianism, but unfortunately, people aren't, and that's the problem. So that's where I sit on things, just so we're clear. And when you see government, like we did in the previous segment, coming to this gargantuan thing with really, I mean, this is like the worst thing that could happen anywhere. And it's, you can't negotiate with insanity, Republicans, state and national. You can't. You have to fight it. I'm doing my best here to fight it, basically. And, you know, I'm here if you want to talk to me, you know, and typically people don't, and that's okay. I'm perfectly okay with that. I'll keep doing as I'm doing. And, you know, not that I have every answer, but I am willing to speak out about it. And I am willing to propose solutions. And these are solutions that we're not seeing anywhere. Show me where the solutions are bad or where they need to be reworked. Perhaps I need to be educated. The idea is, as JFK, John F. Kennedy, the 35th president of the United States would say, is let us get to the right answer. Not the Republican answer, not the Democrat answer, the right answer. And that's really what we need so critically in this time that we are in now, in this crazy, crazy universe of the United States of America. But anyway, you would be terribly disappointed if I didn't leave you with some jokes. I'm still on this love thing. It's spring, you know, the flowers are blooming. The winter is over, I hope, I pray. And I've got some more romance jokes for you. And these all kind of come down to bad pickup lines. We may not be socks, but I know we'd make a great pair. About that. Knock, knock. Who's there? Orange. Orange who? Aren't you going to kiss me? Let's commit the perfect crime together. Well, for that, you got to be in politics. I'll steal your heart and you can steal mine. If you were a vegetable, you'd be a cucumber. This one's really neat. Guys, I suggest this to you. Go to a lovely young lady and say, would you have the time? And she would give you the time, ostensibly. and you would say thank you, and then you would say, you know, I have a very expensive watch, but I wasn't looking at that because I can't take my eyes off of you. That one's good. Now, if you use that successfully, come back and tell me, I will be pleased. If you get punched in the eye, you pays your money, you takes your chances. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. Thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us. Keep fighting the good fight. Remember, it's not a good fight unless you win. And as Dick Clark would say on American Bandstand, so long. We'll be back next week with an even better show.